Yes. We're gonna do Hangouts. The problem is that I don't know if we can do, like, screen share with him as well. Alright. Hey, Ezra.
Hey, man. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes, we can hear you now.
Awesome.
this is Ezra. Yeah, no problem. Everyone let us know if the volume is okay.
All right. So I'm just adjusting my mic real quick.
Yeah, I don't know what happened with Skype, but I'll do screen share. We'll just work with whatever we have.
Yeah, so basically whenever the Skype call would pop up, it would just Skype would just crash and disappear.
Oh man.
So I just updated it thinking like, oh, I better update, but
I'm actually on an older version of Skype.
Yeah.
I'm on Skype 7.0. Huh. I think it's not the latest version. I had to downgrade it. But Yeah, anyway, let's go ahead and get started.
Cool.
Now that that's all good. Are you seeing my screen? It should be just the memory of a broken dimension website. Oh, whoops. Yeah. Is screen share working?
Yeah, it is now. Yeah.
Okay.
I guess there's probably... I don't know how much of a delay there is, but yeah, it's working now.
All right. Well, I've got the me and 23 viewers say hi from JJR Cop. All right.
I'm going to try to join the Twitch chat just so I have an idea if there's any questions or anything like that.
Sure. Yeah, and I can also read them too. We just had... Okay, Relics just crashed, but we'll try it again. okay, there we go. We are now... starting. And so you said this is not the latest build. It just was one that was stable.
Yeah, this is the most stable, although now I'm noticing more, you know, crashing issues.
All right. So I know you said I had to hit escape first, and then this is where Relics VR Surveyor. Just gonna click around here a bit. By the way, so like you've been you're a developer. Just so people who are new know you, you're based in Seattle, and you've been working on Memory of a Broken Dimension for a few years now.
Yeah, it's correct. It was basically beginning of 2014 when I switched over to like going full time on the project, and then when I did that, that kind of included just sort of rebuilding it from scratch because the original was very, very hacky and like it wouldn't really scale to like a full game, so it's been a couple of years now. But the original prototype is from like 2012-ish or something.
Ah, okay. And it's just you working on it?
Yeah.
All right.
I have had some help with some music in the game,
mm-hmm.
But it's like nothing official yet with who's been involved.
Right. And this is being written in Unity, by the way, right?
Yeah, it's Unity, and it's I'm still in 4.6.
You are?
Yeah. So I was trying, like I was really looking forward to using Unity 5. Like I like some of the command buffer features and stuff like that, but I rely a lot on the Beast light mapping system, so I haven't really been able to make the switch.
Completely. Oh, man. Yeah. The new light mapping, I haven't even gotten to try it because it takes so long to light
map.
Yeah,
I mean, it's like there's good things about it, but then there's also some like bad things if you're going for more just like totally baked like light map style stuff.
Right. All right, and then we have this thing down here,
which does nothing.
Does nothing.
Yeah, so I could kind of explain like this kind of it's like the desktop is the main menu, but I haven't really touched working on the desktop in a while because I'm planning to go back to more of the command line terminal type thing from the original prototype. I mean, there'll still be like graphical UI stuff, but I want to try and get back to more of the like the high contrast black and white UI, because I feel like this strayed a little bit from like the visual direction that the project was going in originally.
Mm-hmm. Have you played Duskers yet?
No, I don't think I have. No.
Right, that has it's like a roguelike game. You control drones in spaceships top down, but
it's all
done through the console.
Yeah. I've seen like it was either a video or like a Let's Play type thing of it.
Mm-hmm.
It looks cool. It's also a similar type of ideas as far as like drones and different types of vision modes for checking, you know, like exploring abandoned things in space.
Right. Vivasser in the chat says he's had the same issue, or they had the same issue with regards to not being able to switch from 4.6 due to light mapping. I actually wasn't able to use 4.6 at all. I had all my scenes couldn't open up in 4.6.
Oh, wow.
So when I switched to 5, I actually had to rebuild everything, which I sort of needed to do anyway. But that's sort of, I think, kind of one of those things that as you you sort of are like, okay, I can see why you'd want to write your own engine.
Yeah.
If you sort of like knew very early on what you wanted to do, etc.
I mean, I like Unity, but there's always some stuff that like you want to do differently, and you're limited by the engine, but it's good for a lot of other reasons. So, but I think too, like it seems like they plan on, resolving some of the issues that people are having. So hopefully, I don't know. I probably won't upgrade the project because I think I'm just too far along in 4.6 right now. But future projects probably would be on 5.
Right. I put the Google Hangout window just because when you talk, it like the circle gets bigger, and I feel like I'm talking to an AI, which I think is appropriate.
You should hit escape and it'll drop back from the desktop.
Yep.
Just so people aren't staring at the
right. So now we are into the game. So actually, one of the things that and I think a lot of people are very excited about is just the shaders. So first of all, I'm like super happy you were nominated for IGF Art, because I feel like just from seeing a lot of the stuff that's there, they tend to be like cutesy. If you go for like a very cute aesthetic, that seems to do well. And I think your game is like not a, how would you say it, traditionally pretty looking game.
I
think it's beautiful, different. But it's definitely
I was pretty happy that it got nominated. Like, it was cool. I kind of like thinking about it more, I feel like maybe I entered, I was like a little too eager to enter the project like when I did. Like, I don't know. I think I've done that a few times now where it's like I submit the project somewhere, but it might be better to wait longer until it's like fully realized.
But it's always hard to know, you know. That's like that's kind of like a hindsight thing maybe.
Yeah, definitely.
And also like a lot of the stuff that's really cool with shaders is that you're doing stuff that I didn't even think was possible. Which I think is really cool. By the way, so just so people know, I'm running it on a 970.
Okay.
And it feels like it's 60 frames per second. It's super smooth.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I'm seeing I would have no idea from the Hangout stream. So
Yeah, it's really
actually,
smooth. I mean, it's doing like the data moshing thing, but like it's when I'm moving around though, I can tell just based on the movement that it's at 60, which
yeah, cool. Yeah,
yeah.
the surprising thing is that as far as the graphics, like the rendering goes, I'm
Right.
still using DirectX 9 level stuff.
Oh wow.
So like if the game like if this was like, 2009, the game would look the same. Like I haven't actually used any of the DirectX 12 or 11 or 10 or any of that stuff yet.
Right, I see. So, oh wow. Huh,
So
interesting.
I'm trying to like it's I mean it's kind of I'm in one way it's kind of like not dumb, but it's like I'm probably going through more pain trying to do stuff. Or there's certain things that would be easier if I was just using the latest. But I was kind of worried early on when I was prototyping the project because like just I think it was like OpenGL on Mac and Linux didn't really have the same support for beyond DirectX 9 level stuff.
Right.
So I just kind of wanted to try and keep it at like the lowest specs, but I think I don't know. I'm kind of aiming for like any computer from like the past 6 or 7 years should be able to run
Right.
it.
Yeah, JJR Cop says that he says you posted some stuff on Twitter about the struggle of diagnosing bugs in something that's supposed to look glitchy.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so just so we're like, okay, we're starting out in this kind of area, this platform here, and there's sort of a lot of stuff to like look at already. I'm also noticing like there's this like really wonderful grid fading in and out. So are you doing anti-aliasing here?
No,
No.
I've been purposely trying to avoid anti-aliasing. I mean, I think you can still enable it, but there's issues sometimes where it like flips the UV coordinates.
Right. Yeah, if I look at the edges, I can see a bit of it, but I think the way that the smearing is happening sort of like makes it not that important.
Yeah. And the other thing, there's kind of like a highlight where the geometry cuts through. There's basically a big box or a cube around this area, so it's if the geometry cuts through the face of the box, it'll highlight it. So that's why everything has kind of like a white edge to it.
Oh, I see. Yeah. All right. So anyway, this is the area, and I can see there's a space
There's
on
also
top.
some world wrapping in here too.
Oh, there is.
Yeah.
Okay.
I can't tell if you've encountered it yet though,
I
but
don't think so. What? Tell me when was this built? Like the last time I played it was at SIGGRAPH 2014.
this is from like March, April of this year. This is
Okay. Yeah.
the build that I showed at GDC.
Okay. You mean you? Oh, right, because I did on the IGF floor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I guess this level it was mostly just like there's kind of an end to it and a progression blocking type of puzzle, but
Okay.
it's mainly for people to sort of take in the atmosphere and
Right.
visuals and audio and stuff.
By the way, I think I actually had the volume for it totally set to zero, and I'll bring it up to one just so we can hear a bit of it. And I see now there's a set of stairs here that I can
Yeah.
go down. It's what's really incredible is like even with all the insane visuals going on, you can still see like you sort of slow. It really forces you to slow down.
Yeah.
Whoa.
So that was one of the world wrapping type things. I mean, it's different to what you're doing, but it's like the general concept is you're exploring these like sectors of information or like blocks, like memory blocks.
Right.
And when you cross over the boundary of one of them, you drop into another, which might be like it might be like misaligned or something, so you end up in a different part of the level. Like it's sort of not too important for the players to know that, but it's kind of like how I've been thinking about it when I design the levels.
I see.
And then this is the progression blocking area where there's a bridge that you can't get across until you do something else.
And I didn't notice when I jumped, the screen turned to black.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So
it's like, it's more just, yeah. I mean, not when I jump, but when I hit spacebar.
Yeah. So that's a vision, or it's like, it's supposed to be a vision mode that helps direct the player a little bit. I don't know if you, did you see particles when holding spacebar?
I do not. It's completely black.
Oh, okay. So this must be some compatibility issue then.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. This is good to see, but it also means there's going to be like tons of weird issues people have. I put it on spacebar because I figured people would try to jump.
Right.
But it's just sort of like how some games have like vision modes.
Oh yeah.
This thing, it's not really to see through walls, but it relates to the idea of like 3D scanning, like 3D laser scanning and stuff.
So I noticed when I walked through this, so I went back out, and if I do this, then that teleports me back, so it doesn't let me continue. So I guess I'm gonna continue down into this space here. And there's something I have to do now. Is the spacebar going to?
Well, no, it doesn't have any effects in here. Even though you can't see the effects, you don't have to worry about it too much.
And then just in terms of the controls, it is just WASD, and am I missing left click or right click? I don't think it told me anything.
Oh, yeah, there is a left click and right click. So if you hold left mouse and aim it like a dark area, it should look like it's kind of highlighting and scanning.
Yes, oh yeah, I see that.
So that's, in effect, it's kind of like a flashlight, but it just helps get through some of the dark areas.
Right. I think I know what I'm supposed to do here. And what I think I need to do is find a perspective where these things line up.
Yeah, yeah. And, like, I've... There definitely is. And I already know that it's confusing because of the same area other people have played. So the spot that you're supposed to go is not in this room that you're in.
Oh, it's not in this room.
Yeah, no, but you have the right idea.
Yes. I wonder if... okay. Because so far, what I see as the two areas are...
Try walking off that ledge there.
This one?
Yeah.
Oh, interesting. Huh.
So this is where that spacebar effect would come in.
Oh, got it.
It would kind of hint at the... I've been calling them ports or connections between areas, but it was already busted in this build, but it looks like it's not even drawing for you, so...
Right.
So there are a few hidden walls, which... they're not really intended to be hidden walls.
Right.
Oh, you've already found a... I should just let you play.
Yeah. It, and I know this, too, for you is a big, inspiration is, Blame?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
I like the general idea of, like, big, spaces, like, even at, like, ruins, urban exploration type stuff. So Blame is like the crazy sci-fi cyberpunk version of that.
Yeah. Oh, hey.
So if you left click. Yeah.
There we go. You're right.
And that's just a placeholder art for an artifact. And the idea is that there's there's different artifacts that are kind of scattered throughout the environment, and they, some of them hold pieces of data, or they have effects on the environment, and it, right. they kind of help you navigate.
Let me just catch up on the chat. This is someone, 8% 4321 says this is deeply giving a stalker vibe. I'm assuming talking about the Tarkovsky film.
Yeah, either that or the game Stalker.
Oh, I didn't know there was a game Stalker.
Okay. The game is kind of based on the film, or maybe like based on Roadside Picnic.
Okay.
I'm a fan of both. Like,
I mean, nothing happens in the film.
Yeah.
All I remember, they go on a boat ride and then like talk. This is like a long time ago when I saw it.
Yeah, same here.
Wait, I saw something.
I'm watching the chat too. As far as Nyasense, I still don't know how to pronounce it. I think it's, I mean, it's influenced me now, but I think when I started the project, it was before I had heard of the game, although I'd seen one of the guys, I don't know how many people are on it, but they did some other game. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Cool.
For 5 years. So
I'd seen, like, he did some other earlier experiments that were similar, like a similar take on these really big, like, mega structure style environments.
Whoa. That's neat.
Yeah, that's it's kind of like a save upload point.
Ah, okay.
And it's basically like any of the artifacts that you find, the intention is that you can drop them in these spots and they'll be transferred to your desktop. Right. But that's like, at the time of this build, that was not fully working. And since there isn't really a tutorial, like there's a little meter on the lower right corner of your screen, and it's kind of like signal strength or transmission speed or something like that, and it affects like how easily you can see the environment. I'm not sure, are you stuck right now or?
There was like a, it had like a, when I continue that pipe, continued following the pipe, it takes me to like a death. It's like the point where you fall off, you keep landing back.
Oh, okay.
Just off, it's right here. So you can see it's like you miss it. Let me grab this. I think I need to be like clicking it. Isn't this like one of the things that was shown earlier that I could pick up with the left mouse button?
Yeah. I'm wondering, I'm not sure why. You might have to just back up a little. It might be just a trigger type thing.
Huh. Yeah. So it was like this point where when I came off the pipe, there's like this little ledge, and when you jump off, I think it respawns you like,
oh,
kind of a little too close to the edge, so you always end up falling off.
Yeah. That's a reoccurring issue. Like it's because all the like where it picks to respawn you is based on where it thinks is the best position.
Right.
So I have to kind of adjust the thresholds. I'm actually using the nav mesh for that. Like it tries to find the nearest point on the nav mesh.
There we go. I walked up there to the left and came through this room. And I'm now in somewhere new. Yeah, so now the left mouse button is really handy.
Yeah, like, okay. Really, yeah, it's meant really for nice this area.
Yeah.
Cool.
And so tell me a bit about so just in terms of the visual, it is like nothing I've ever seen. Let's catch up. Meta Real World is here. Hello. you're like exploring a weird emulator for an old system that got dropped somewhere and spread around the internet. Yeah, I think that's J.J.R.
Yeah,
Papp is talking about that.
that's correct. Yeah.
Everyone's saying this looks delicious, beautiful pixels. Yeah, I kind of wanted to talk to you, like, in terms of just the visuals, how did this come about? Like, when you started, did you have a very clear idea, or was it just you started playing with shaders and then this looked cool, so you went with that?
Yeah, I started just playing with shaders. Like, it's been kind of a lot. Like, it's not been a ideal process, I guess. Like, basically, I didn't know shader programming, and I knew like all the cool effects that I knew were from before shaders, where it's like you're dealing with actual like back buffers and pixels and stuff, like more like what you would see in the like the mid 90s demo scene and older.
Okay, right.
So that was like kind of what I knew, and I wanted to like do 3D stuff, but shaders was kind of intimidating. And so I tried Unity, and I think it was like Unity 2.6, and I think I hated it, so I didn't really give it much time.
Oh, so that was
And
super early Unity. Yeah.
yeah, and then I came back to Unity when when it was version 3.0, and I don't know, I mean, either I just spent more time with it, or like I was in a better mood using it or something, but I stuck using it, and then started doing like I think it was like these monthly game jams on, I forget the site, but they would announce a theme. Like it wasn't Ludum Dare, it was some other thing. But yeah, I just started messing with shaders and basically taking Unity shaders, like their image effects, and changing values to kind of see what different, you know, different commands do and stuff.
Yeah, that's how I approached it.
Yeah, and that from there, that's kind of how I've continued to work. Although I think I know shaders a bit more, but it's like there's still certain things where I don't really know exactly. You know, it's not like I can think like, oh, I just have to do these things to do this effect.
Right.
Usually involves like a bunch of research.
Yes. Yeah, like I'm currently right now looking into doing temporal anti-aliasing.
Oh
And I think
yeah.
that's a combination of sort of taking the sort of like reverse engineering the Unity motion blur shader.
Yep, yeah.
And then, yeah, trying to blend that, I think.
That's what I how I ended up with one of the main effects in this game is the motion blur shader.
This like smearing effect, right?
Yeah, it's like so the basic thing is I think it's the same for temporal anti-aliasing. It's like the I think they call it like reprojection or something, where you look at the depth buffer of the current frame, and then you look at the depth buffer of the prior frame, and then you get the world position from that, and you basically see like, okay, the pixels or like what the pixels are currently over have moved like this far in world space, and then that's like a velocity vector, and so then you can use that for like all kinds of stuff.
Right, so you're not just doing like general ghosting,
No,
right? That
yeah, it's
that's
actual like it uses the camera velocity and has like another texture that is like an accumulation buffer, and there's some masking and stuff, and it continually writes into that
I
and
see.
then smears it basically. This is more than that. Like it's sort of like Photoshop layers or something. Like there's different masks that I've been using for bringing in different effects
Right.
into like a final composite of things.
Some of the questions. Red Garlic says he's been following it since Greenlight. And Meta Real World says there's a lot of time-dependent action going on here. Really engaging. Do you operate on much history? I guess like do you need to keep multiple frames in the buffer, or do you just
Oh
need to?
yeah, that's yeah. There's Well, there's a few things, like I guess a couple topics, directions. Like there's the like the direct camera movement, which is I think it's just the prior frame that it looks at and the current frame. But then the there is a buffer that it sort of has almost like a timer on how quickly it clears away.
I see.
And that's the one that's being written into. So it but the I'm trying to think of how to explain it. Like the speed or like actually wait, let me so a good way to think about it is like the player's like camera is has like a big paintbrush around it, like an actual 3D sphere. Mm-hmm. And the radius of this paintbrush is like changing based on their signal strength. So if they have higher signal strength, they can see further, and that is sort of like what's painting into one of the buffers that like basically stores what the player can see in the environment.
When you say signal strength, that's like a variable, or is that that's a variable that's, that you set, or it's actually changing depending on the
it's
geometry?
Changing.
Oh,
yeah,
I see.
It's that's the little meter thing.
Oh, got it,
lower,
got it.
Lower right corner.
So that's actually affecting how strongly the effects are being applied.
Yeah, yeah. So if you go, it's really right now it's just mostly tied to lighting, and I'm trying to figure out a good way to change that. But so I've been that put another constraint on the project that is kind of interesting but kind of stupid, where like all my light sources have to be exterior lighting, like no actual artificial light sources. But the yeah, like the signal strength is sort of, because I guess the overall goal is I've always liked, like if you're watching video streams or like even really old video streams like Real Player, stuff like that, where you'll have some packet loss or whatever, and then the video gets all messed up. So I wanted to have like a real time version of that where it's like, I mean, it's almost like you're streaming this from somewhere else, trying to play through an environment that way.
David Kimmer asked, you find yourself having to learn a lot of math?
I guess kind of. I've always done really bad with math, so it's like I think I've learned more, but the thing that always gets me is like trying to look at any of those like more like official PDFs about like shader techniques or graphics things, because they always use like different or you know some kind of like notation for the math stuff. And so that's like a whole different language to me.
Yeah, there's also, I think, one thing with, because right, you want to avoid if else, you want to avoid conditionals in your shader. So there's a lot of like matrix multiplication you can do to kind of replace that. You know what I'm talking about?
Maybe. I'm still trying to wrap my head around matrices, actually.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, it's basically because, like, if you, instead of doing, like, if this, then that, you basically set it to be where if it's 1, it goes through with the calculation, and if it's 0, it doesn't, right? And then you can just set up your matrix so that it, like, all the things that would be true end up getting multiplied by 1.
Cool.
Yeah. I've been with this David Lasky. He's been a programmer helping me, and I write the shaders with conditionals, and then I just give it to him.
Cool. So he ports it to not use conditionals.
Yeah, just so that it's a little more efficient. I mean, I still don't know exactly how much you're saving, but that is one thing that like people will bring up and be like, conditionals are not very efficient.
I've started using conditionals, but I should maybe do something. Actually, like the one thing I did do is I just needed to check if it was more for like a bit mask where you have a byte and then you have 8 bits to the byte, and I wanted to see like which of those 8 bits were on or off.
Right.
And since I'm still on DirectX 9 or Shader Model 3.0, like you can't really do any like bitwise operations or whatever they call it. So I had to do, I didn't want to do if then. So I did something using the step function where like it, I forget what it does actually, but it's like it just basically is similar to that 0-1 thing. Like if it's one, then the value is multiplied by that and it works. If it's zero, then it's
right.
Zero.
It also reminds me of the way you do like Gaussian blur, because the way you sample it, you know, let's say you're sampling the pixels around it, and instead of doing it on a 5x5 grid, you actually want to do it, you want to blur the x along the x-axis first, and then blur along the y-axis first.
Oh, yeah.
Because then you're, that way you sample a 2n instead of n squared. Yeah, there's like all these kind of, but like you get the same results, but there's sort of all these tricks, pretty much. Yeah, they're basically tricks to become much more efficient.
Yeah, that's the stuff like I try to pick up on, but it's weird because, like, for example, you can look at like Unity, like built-in image effect shaders and like other stuff, and people might be using those tricks, but like I have no idea if like one way is like the most optimal best way to do it, or if I'm using like somebody's method which isn't as good as another. So it's like usually a lot of trial and error when I'm dealing with stuff that I don't fully understand yet.
Let's see. How are you drawing the artifacts? Is someone's asking. I'm not too sure which artifacts he's talking about.
Oh, is it like the wireframe stuff?
I think he must be talking about the wireframe.
That's it's a mesh with a mesh that is drawing as lines instead of like triangles, or yeah, I think it must be triangles. And if you're using Unity, it's the mesh topology thing. So I set the mesh topology to lines, and then I'm feeding it just kind of like a random noise texture.
Right.
And then in the shader for it, it reads, in the vertex shader, it reads the pixel values and uses those as XYZ coordinates for the vertex.
I see. I'm gonna get to another question, but first I think I might need some help with where the game is. Like I've gotten a good sense of what this space is, and I see there's like the stairs that goes down, and we have this pipe.
Oh yeah, you'll want to follow the pipe.
But then it takes me to that ledge, where if I fall off, it's not. Like we go to this pipe, and then it takes me to that ledge where I just fall off.
And then it might be. I think I might know what you're talking about.
Like it goes to.
If it is, it's due to my, the lighting and level design.
Yeah, so here you see this, right, and then.
Yeah.
Or do I go?
Walk up that little ramp and then turn to your right.
Oh, right. Okay.
It's not like, so this level 2 it's not going to be in the final game.
Right.
It's, but there is, I've trying to remember. There is another tricky spot. I'll try and see if I catch it when you're walking around.
So now I'm back out here in this.
Oh, there's a few directions you can go from here.
Yeah. Let me just get to another question. 010101FF. He asks, besides packet loss / any other sector damage reference or experience with that influenced the style? Is there other references or experience with that influenced the style?
Yeah, there's a lot of different influences. It's like... trying to think of it's kind of, in a way, it's like it's just everything that I like from a certain area of like things I like, I guess. But
right.
The like one of the big things is actually like sumi painting, or like ink wash painting, which
is that
like not
a Japanese style painting or something. I'm not familiar with it.
I guess sumi would be Japanese, and then there's ink wash painting. Like I don't know the the proper names for it, but it's just any, I mean, you could even say like watercolor, but right. I like most of the stuff that has the black inks and it's like trying to be, you know, very simple brush strokes that have somehow create these like crazy textures. So I kind of wanted to have like a visual effect that had that same like complexity to it and kind of fluidness, I guess, but like digital. So that's kind of how it crossed from that to like the glitch, like data compression stuff. And I think also like as far as the environments, it's like Doom and Quake style level design.
Right.
Because I that's sort of what I grew up playing. So I just really like the claustrophobic, like maze-like levels and with lots of different routes and things. Oh, okay, so here there's the stairs that you just walked up.
Yeah.
This is tricky, but if you walk like directly where the stairs are facing, it should transfer you to a different area. And then here's where you can...
now I'm back in the area.
Yeah, that's the issue. The ledge up there is too short, so people always walk and jump off.
Yeah. Now I'm getting a good sense of it. The nice thing is, like, it really doesn't bother me to kind of retrace my steps because visually it's just so pleasing to look at, and it is very atmospheric. That just navigating is like really a really pleasant, or not pleasant, engaging. I mean, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It's it's like because so when the project started, it was just something I just was making. Like, I didn't really have a good reason for making it other than, like, I just wanted to mess with shaders and, like, make something that I enjoyed looking at. So it's still kind of retained that, where it's, like, sure, there are some game-like qualities to it. Like, I have an idea of the plot and stuff and things that the player might think they want to accomplish. But overall, like, it's still really just about, like, exploring this place and kind of taking in, like, these crazy visuals and seeing what happens and stuff.
Right. Hey, Arnold Vanier from Bokita is here.
Oh, cool.
HDK V12. Someone, let's see.
Oh, I see there's a question.
Yeah, about the game mechanic where you clicked on things and it turned solid.
Yeah, that's still in. That's actually what you're about to do.
Right. We're getting bridge. There.
The prototype, like I feel like it was, I used that a ton, and I think at the time when I was making that, I was like, I don't know, I thought like I would be able to pull out a ton of variations of the mechanic in interesting ways, right. But I don't, maybe it's still possible to, but I seem to have like struggled with doing that. So the whole sinking thing is, it's still in the game, but I've kind of tried to limit the areas where you do it, where it's like more of a like a finale to prior events.
Right. Actually, so I'm curious, just in terms of how the game has evolved. When it started, it was like a puzzle game based on that get perspective right and turn to solid.
Yeah, I was thinking that, you know, it has like, and I don't know, I just felt like it needed some kind of central mechanic at that time. And then it still has that kind of mechanic of like fixing or completing the environment, but I've just tried to not make it so like binary, where it's like on off, like you've clicked and fixed it or it's not fixed. The thing I've been trying to do more of now is like, making things a little more like not analog, but sort of with, you know, it's more about quantities of things. So if you have like a few of certain items and a few of these, that might have a different effect, almost like magnet and like electromagnetic stuff.
Oh, I see where this is going now, right? Because it's a very 2D thing. I'm filling in the bridge with the broken pixels.
Yeah, and I think you just have to click, and it's actually...
There we go.
Cool.
Yeah, and out of curiosity, so like, how is that done? I mean, just kind of the rough technical of it. Are you breaking up the shader and then projecting it? Because I actually thought of trying to do something like that. I had like this idea early on. I think when Monument Valley came out, a lot of people were like, oh man, you should do these perspective things. It wasn't quite like this, but I would have like an image, like on the window, I'd draw a set of stairs, and the idea was you would like get the lines lined up correctly, and a stairs would then be there that you could go back and walk. But I could never get the perspective right. Like, it always looked off. Like, I would take a screenshot, I would put stairs in there, take a screenshot, go to Photoshop, outline it, and then try to bring it back, and I could never get it to work, and ended up just giving up on it. But here it worked really well.
Yeah, the technical thing is, in what I'm doing is I basically subdivide the polygons of a mesh, and I had made like sort of some editor tools to help me do this, where it's like for that bridge, there's a bounding box, and the bounding box looks at what meshes are. It just goes through all the meshes basically, and then it tries to cut the mesh by the bounds, so by six planes. and then the new mesh for the bridge gets subdivided, and then those triangles use like vertex color. And the vertex color is just sort of like an ID for being used in the shader. Mm-hmm. And then I'm able to, in the shader, like multiply the original position of the vertex with like a normal that is in the vertex color by a distance, and also some scaling stuff. That's what kind of pushes it out. There's more to it than that, but it's mainly vertex color that's controlling like the direction that the vertices should move in.
Okay, interesting. And that just sort of allows it to line up correctly in that perspective?
Yeah, like in the platform there's an invisible object that's placed that is at the camera height, and then the bridge mesh is associated with that object. So there's like some editor tools that I made which will basically set the vertex colors and give them vector threes that point at that position.
I see.
And then in the shader it looks at those and just sort of like because basically the mesh starts at how it should look. So I just add the vector three with like a certain distance towards that point.
Got it.
And it somehow works like it, if they go to 100% to the point, then all the vertices are at a single point. So it doesn't look right. But if I kind of like offset how far along that line they travel, then it looks better. Like, like a cloud of fragments and stuff.
I see. Some questions. 8%4321 asks, you've played Cairo?
Yeah, I have. Yeah.
Yeah, that was, I played it as well, and it definitely had I think it's a very personal game, which I really like. Sort of one of the earlier indie titles with first person exploration. Curious, what did you think of it?
I enjoyed it. I played it on... I think I played it also in VR when he added the VR support.
Man. Wow,
Just to, like, because I was really curious about VR stuff at that time. But I think maybe some of the puzzles were too like difficult or like vague for me.
Yeah, I think they had the sort of similar to Myst, where every puzzle had a different system.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
There sort of wasn't a consistent stream.
Yeah, I mean, I got through it and I enjoyed it. Like, it was the type of game where it took me a long time to finish it, but it was like I was really determined to finish it.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas, like, there's other games I play where it's like, you know, I would lose interest or it wouldn't really keep my interest the whole time, but it kept my interest.
Right. HD. So we seem to answer David Kilmer's question about the meshes. Offset Bay. Arnold asks, he says this reminds him of Zaxi or Dirac. Did you work on those?
Oh, no, I didn't work on those. Mm-hmm. I think maybe, I mean, I know I've I think they're both by Ori Haas. I know, like, early on we talked about shaders, but yeah, I haven't worked on them.
Also, I want to point out these stairs. Are these intentional, the white stairs?
No, that's an actual bug.
Okay, so see, I used to see that. I think that's something to do with the light mapping. Is that, am I correct?
Yeah,
I used to see stuff like that.
Yeah, it's, there's, there's, in this build, there's some crazy stuff that I'm using the light mapping for.
Although I was going to say, you have this wonderful advantage of, this totally could fit, like it, with mine, when it was a bug, it really stood out. And here it's like, I'm like, I don't know. This looks like it works. Like, I feel like you could, your aesthetic sort of, in a way, allows you to get away with actual bugs.
Yeah. It's funny, though, because I still, like, I notice the bugs, actually. Like,
right.
Things that, like, these stairs and other things, like, I've seen this so much that it's sort of easy for me to pick out what looks wrong, like,
right.
Or like what I'm, you know, not wanting it to look like. So I'm wondering if you want me to try streaming some in editor stuff.
Since we sort of passed that first puzzle, and I just want to walk a little bit. So why don't we just so this area, like, I'm noticing when I jump down, it kills me. Does it? Or it's doing that, like, fall. Is that intentional? Like, do you notice when I go from the stairs to the ground, there's almost this, like, falling animation, and then it... And I... Or I think it's trying to kill me.
Yeah. Well, it is kind of intentional, but usually I've seen it where people can reach the doorway in here.
Oh, I see. Okay, let me just...
You might have to... But
I see it now.
Okay. That was thrown in there as just sort of like to switch up, because people think, you know, they're from playing up until that point, like they expect that they're gonna wrap around every time.
Right.
But it actually, did you just fall for a while and then it reset you?
I went out somewhere and then it got a little bit farther.
Oh, okay.
You were also in the Experimental Gameplay Workshop in 2013, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Quinto Lloyd says they remember seeing this game there. So, actually, why don't we switch over to your desktop? We'll control Alt F4 out of this.
Yeah,
because we have about like half an hour left. It's just a little under half an hour. So I thought, yeah, we haven't done this before, but we're going to have Ezra show us kind of some of the behind the scenes stuff, which is very cool.
Because I could at least try to show the render passes.
Let me stop screen sharing on my end, and now this is just let me see if I can make this, hold on just a second, let me see if I can make this a little bit bigger. Google Chrome caps it, so it's a little bit smaller, but hopefully you guys can all still see it. By the way, A-Person asks, do you keep a list of unintentional bugs for later possible intentional use?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, not like an official list, but,
yeah.
I do keep Note of weird things that look cool.
So right now we're looking at this is the game view
Yeah, and
for you
this is
now.
like straight from the latest that I'm working on,
Oh wow, these are so we're
so.
not getting great frame rate, but I can, is that particle effects?
Yeah, and there should be a floating artifact.
I see that, yeah.
That's the new artifact. They float when you approach them, and they drop when you
Just this
move
looks
away.
incredible. What? Okay, first I've always wanted to ask you because I didn't think the particle system that was possible. Like you're, would you know what how many particles you're using here?
Well, so the I'm gonna try and show the so basically the it's mesh particles.
Right.
I'm flipping through the render passes right now.
Right.
So this is it's one mesh that has like about 65,000 vertices,
I see. I
and
see.
it's instead of rendering as triangles, it renders as just the points.
Right.
And then doing the same thing where somebody had asked about the artifact, like how is doing lines, like you just feed it a texture, and since it's like 65,000 points, you just feed it a 256 by 256 texture.
Right.
And then each pixel corresponds to one of the vertices, and then you can do like whatever you want with that texture, and it'll push the vertices around.
Wow.
So that's kind of, yeah, that's part of the thing that is doing these the particles.
And when you were showing us, I saw before we had, like, when you were walking through the meshes, there was like the blue greenish version. That was like without any fancy stuff applied. Was that what was
Yeah,
happening?
I think let me see if I could go through this in a coherent way.
Right. Chat's going crazy. A person says, amazing. David Kilmer says, holy shit.
So
Okay, wow.
what I'm showing now is the wireframe rendering,
Right.
and this is one of the things that's mixed on top, and then this is just lighting. But
Oh, I
you can
see.
kind of see, I'm not sure what it looks like in the stream, but you see that you can clearly see there's like kind of fractured triangles and stuff.
We're seeing like this gray area, and then there's just these lines, these cracks
Yeah.
and pieces missing.
So that's the what you're asking about with the fra like the fragmenting. And I'm gonna try and just one second, just try to like reset their positions. Oh, maybe it doesn't work. Okay, so now it's back to normal. So I can basically control
What?
how much everything.
What? Wow, and that's all through shader. That's the vertex
Yeah.
shader.
So
Wow.
these are static meshes, but I can animate them. So
Oh, right. 'Cause so the
they're
collider is like
moving.
what it was before.
Yeah.
Wow.
And so I'm gonna go back to, so this is like the, 'cause I've been trying to optimize and make stuff work better. So these
Right.
are here, this view, it looks similar, but it's more monochrome. But these are basically the individual groups of those pieces, and it uses the vertex alpha for that.
The individual, oh, I see, like each
So
color is one thing.
yeah, so I kind of the mesh gets subdivided into smaller triangles, and then I have like volume, like these bounds, and they assign groups of triangles, and then the actual individual triangles have they have their own IDs, which is in the vertex red and green color, because Unity has this encode float to RG,
Yeah,
so that you,
I
yeah,
see.
and that's really useful, because basically instead of 256 values, it's up to like 32,000. So I
Oh,
have a lot more unique triangles this way. So it's like there's the group, which is I have max 256 groups per area, and then there's like the individual triangles.
So, like, just to, so I'm clear, it's like you have these separate meshes that are all over the place. Broken. So they're all broken up. They're like not with the meshes. It's not like that one box is one mesh. You sort of have like
Oh,
one thing
it's all
going.
one mesh.
Oh, the
It's all
whole
one
thing is
mesh.
one mesh. I
Yeah,
see.
yeah.
And then that's broken up into separate groups. And
Yeah,
then.
it's the only individual meshes are based on material type.
Oh, got
So
it.
that was to 'cause I was using you know how you can do like static batching and stuff?
Yes.
So I still do static batching, but I just kind of like helped it a little bit. So when the level I know you'd seen before, but when I launch, it says like baking block, and there's like a progress bar.
Right.
That's doing the Unity's like what's it called? It's like on post-process scene or something like that, and that's like super useful. You can do all kinds of crazy editing to the actual scenes, and then they're saved that way for runtime. So that's when I do
Wow.
all the actual mesh editing.
Oh yeah. I think we're doing something similar with our world duplication.
It probably would be, because it's crazy useful. It allows you to like automate all kinds of stuff.
I see. And then when you were talking about the triangle, just so I'm clear, it's like basically what you're saying is you give each triangle an identity, or you color them differently
Yeah, and I just
somehow.
store that in the vertex color.
Oh, I see. And because of the way it's doing the values, it gives you more than 256.
Yeah, so
Yeah.
the red and green is dedicated to triangle unique IDs, and
Oh,
then
I see.
the alpha is like group IDs, so multiple triangles can share those.
Got it. Which right now we're looking at alpha. Yeah.
And then the wireframe is the blue channel, which this is what I was doing. I mentioned before about the binary stuff. So
Yes.
it just uses there's this thing called Barry, like I think it's barycentric coordinates, and you can do wireframe using them. But use all the examples I saw show it using the red, green, and blue channel of the vertex color.
Got it.
And basically, you just need to have like the three vertices for a triangle, like one is red, the other's green, the other's blue. So I just made it so that one is one is two, and the other is four, and then those just are like 3 bits in the in
Wow.
one byte. So that was kind of cool, but like I need to figure out what to do with like the remaining bits, because I've been that's kind of like what I've been doing recently is trying to optimize everything.
Got
So
it.
I need to get more information into like the same texture basically, so that I'm not using as many render textures.
I see. And this is that blue green, this blue
Yeah,
green red.
this is the combo of all those channels. So I was flipping through the
Oh,
individual channels,
I
and this is
see.
like the actual
Wow.
texture.
Yeah. By the way, if
This
anyone in the
is.
chat is lost, this is also a bit over my head as well.
Oh
Like,
yeah, and I'm kind of going quickly through it
yeah.
also. This is just that accumulation buffer I was talking
I
about,
see.
where it's I'll show you the mask, but this is like what is continually getting distorted by the player's movement and also like
Right.
some of the particles.
Right. The
And
particles, they always look like it's a continuous flow, but that's not the like the each particle has a life and death point, right? Like at some point it dies out, or does it? It's so hard to see.
yeah, their lifespan is pretty quick.
Oh,
It's
okay.
and the way the particles work is it just spawns them on whatever the player is looking at.
Got it.
So like if I turn really fast, there's not as many, 'cause it's waiting about like a half a second for new ones to reset to their new position.
Got it.
But yeah, it's since I'm like since they're actually animating in world space, that's how it makes it feel continuous, 'cause like if I move toward them, like there's a bit of perspective to it and
Oh,
stuff.
that's right. That's right. Oh, fascinating. So you have the shader actually on the actual meshes, and that's right. Of course, it's not a post processing when it's happening.
It's actual geometry. Yeah, and then so this one's kind of interesting. It's like this is a cube map. So as the player moves, I only update it every second or so. It just renders. It updates the cube map, but I had to unwrap the cube map onto a single texture using I think it's almost like spherical coordinates or something, so that I could just more easily work with it in the shader. Because there's some weird limitations with cube maps where you can only use 32-bit textures, and I wanted to use a texture with a higher precision.
Just to be clear, cube map, is that the stuff you were talking about with that Valve skybox where it looks like stuff in the distance always looks like it's in the distance?
Kind of, yeah. It's basically, you can think of it as a box.
And around you, right?
And so there's six different textures.
Right,
and,
of course.
And so usually those are, I don't know how they're actually stored, but I needed to put it into one seamless texture so that I could work with it. So that's what this is. And
You needed one seamless texture for the cube map because of a particular effect you were going for.
Yeah, and also because cube maps only, at least in 4.6, I can only use 32-bit color on them.
Got it.
And I needed the higher floating point color.
Got it.
The view that I'm showing now is the mask, the current mask. So this is what actually blends what the player can see with what is in the buffer.
And the sort of noise that's part of the mask.
Yeah, yeah. And this is the cube maps also used for this. Looks like I have. Oh, I know it's. I broke something.
By the way, as everyone is, Ezra's finishing fixing this. We're talking to Ezra about Memory of a Broken Dimension. It's a game that's currently in development. If you like this channel, you should follow my Twitch channel. And also, Ezra is on Twitter, XRA, and then BrokenDimension.com is the website of the game.
Basically the cube map that's being rendered. This is something I'm still working on, but I was doing it differently in the build that you played earlier. But this is kind of for the effect of not being able to see the environment and it taking a while to load in.
Right.
So as I round this corner, it's dark back there, and it's basically, it works like a light source.
Got it.
I think they probably even use cube map style stuff for shadows. This is the particle fluid stuff.
Wow.
It's crazy colors because it's like XYZ is positional.
Wow, yeah. We're not, our frame rate is awful, but even just looking at the images, they're stunning.
Oh, yeah. I should probably not be moving around like crazy. I think that's all that passes, though.
That's just the vertices.
Yeah, just their positional stuff.
Wow. And then you make it... Now, when you make it black and white, is that you just have the grayscale...
Grayscale with a bit of tone mapping.
Got it.
And a little bit of bloom on there. There's some bugs, though, like these triangles that are really white. That's not intended. And it's due to when I subdivide the mesh, some of the vertices don't have the correct values for the wireframe.
Got it. Wow. I'm blown away. I'm sure. I think everyone in the chat is as well. Because I've been talking a lot about shaders. You know, you do assisted with me for the edge detection, and now looking into temporal, which I'm actually putting a bit on the back burner. But But yeah, the stuff you're doing is a whole nother league. Very cool. And so just in terms of, we're almost done with the stream, but like, can you tell us a bit about where the project is right now? Like what's like,
Yeah, it's well, I think the majority of the work is building levels, like building out the environment.
By the way, what do you use to build levels? Do you build them inside Maya and then import them into Unity?
So I started using originally I've been using SketchUp,
Oh,
and
wow,
because
okay.
I really like SketchUp, but now I'm using Modo for all the modeling.
Modo is a 3D software?
Yeah, it's similar to Maya in that you can do modeling and animation and stuff.
Got it.
I just use it for modeling. I only just started using it, so I used it to build the level you played earlier,
Right.
using trial versions of it, and then actually I ended up winning a free copy of it like recently. So
Oh, cool.
now I can use it for the rest of the game, which is awesome.
You know, I don't work for Pro Builder, but I've been using them a
Oh,
lot.
I use Pro Builder too.
Oh, you do? Okay, yeah.
I do rough out stuff with Pro Builder, but it's
Okay.
mainly I use it for like all the system triggers and stuff. Like
Right.
I'll switch to the scene view, although they might be hidden. Or if I
Oh, I see.
basically all the things that define my like visibility sectors and stuff and triggers, it's all Pro Builder.
Got it. Got it. Yeah, because I think you have a lot more curves and weird. Like for
Yeah,
me,
like
because I'm just using boxes that Pro Builder is like the only thing I needed to do. So this is what it looks like in Modo.
it looks like it's freezing or it's not responding. It's probably because I'm running the game at the same time.
Right.
So it's
Oh, I see.
I just have like I have a full like this is the level I was just in, and yeah, it's not liking that I have the game running.
Right. I see. Wow.
But I'm basically I have to finish building the environments that I have planned and then really finalize the more of the system mechanic type stuff. And I kind of changed something again recently,
Right.
which is like, I don't know, it might not be the best idea, but I think in the long run it'll be good because I think it's going in a better direction.
And you have plans to be showing the game at any events anytime soon where
Oh
people.
So this level with the new changes, like I'll be showing it at Indiecade this month.
You're an IndieCade, of course.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Yeah. That's
So that
yeah, so if any of you are going to be in LA for IndieCade, you guys should definitely check it out.
yeah. So that this will be, I mean, yeah, this has to be playable there. Like I can't show the old build ever
Right.
again. But yeah, I'm hopefully like it has to be early next year, like when I'm hoping to release the game.
Okay.
Like, I mean, no official date, but that's just sort of what I'm
Right.
shooting for.
A few questions to Vassar. Well, Vassar was saying he hasn't heard of anyone using, or they haven't heard of anyone using Modo in a while. So this sounds really neat. And Meta Real World says it's super easy, powerful descendant of Lightwave.
I like it. I mean, I'm still learning it. It crashes sometimes, but I
Right.
don't know, it's cool. They
They
have an
all
indie
crash.
version. Yeah.
JJR Cop asks, how was EGX? I don't think you actually went, right? The game was
No,
there.
yeah, I couldn't go. That's just like too far out of my budget right
Right.
now. I assume it went well. I showed the build that you were playing earlier. And I did a Seattle event in September during PAX.
The
The
Seattle
Seattle.
Six, Indy Six or something?
And that went really well. So that was good. Like it was mostly people who had never seen the game or like hadn't heard of it. So that was really good, just to get like fresh, fresh impressions on it.
Right. So you said early next year, not no definitive dates yet, but yeah.
I just need to finish it as soon as possible, basically, and make sure that it's good
And
and solid.
people who want to kind of keep up with the development, you're on Twitter, XRA. There's a website, brokendimension.com. You already got greenlit. Yeah. And is there are there other websites you that's out there right now?
No, I would just say Twitter or brokendimension.com. I do need to get better at posting updates on the green light page. But it's that's actually tricky to do. I mean, trying to do everything is so much extra stuff.
Oh, Gauss-Works from Brigador.
Oh yeah, that was exactly it. Brigador looks awesome.
But you also have done some streaming.
I'm hoping to do more of that, when I get closer, when I work through some of these remaining bug fix type things.
Maybe not at the same time as I am, otherwise I won't have an
No.
audience. Everyone just why watch me struggle or
I do try to check up on your streams though, and
I've seen you
I
chatting in a
missed
few times.
the tree generator one. It looked pretty cool.
I'm sort of like this the last you know how it is. Sometimes you do go a whole weekend, you're just taking care of that admin stuff and you don't get to do any actual development. So I'm like, okay, I really need a I want to get back into reading code and like having everything in my head again.
It's tricky. I go through phases, where I have to work on visual art stuff, and then you get in the groove, and you remember all the hotkeys and stuff, and you could actually work fast, and then you realize it's been 2 months, and now you have to do code, and then you're like, oh crap, I gotta read all this code and remember what I was doing,
Yeah,
and
that was for
that's like a
me.
weird cycle.
Like that was how I feel like I finally solved my issue with the edge detection artifact was it had been like, because I'd been 2 weeks trying to fix some bugs with the shader, and then I was like, you know what? I'm just in that mindset. I'm gonna continue in
I
that, and it
remember
was
when he fixed that. That was awesome.
And it's like you have, but you need to like warm it up before you're like your mind is just in that headspace, and it's so hard to get back in. And you also have to do that with like every aspect of the game.
I mean, I've gotten help with music from a couple artists that I like. They've been kind enough to send some tracks. So I'm hoping to work out something,
Oh,
to continue
yeah.
getting help.
That reminds me of a question someone posted earlier, which was, are you thinking of having doing sound-based effects, like having the sound and the visuals combined to do something?
I mean, that's kind of been a long-term goal. It's I would like to. I would have to figure out a good way to do that. I think I do know a way though. I'll just enable it right now real quick. But yeah, I would like to do that so that the audio and I'm not sure if it's going to show up in the stream, but there's some colored pixels in the upper
Yeah,
left
I can see
corner.
that.
So that is I've I'm that's how I feed in more data to the shaders. I write it into a texture. So that's positions of the artifacts and positions of where the player is and some other things. So if I did audio, I could just feed in a texture of the spectrum analyzer or something.
Oh, I see. Oh, like kind of converting it to a texture and then bringing it into the shader.
But yeah, I don't know. There's a lot of things I want to do, but it's like I can't. This isn't the project where I can do everything I want to do on. That's the other thing.
That's MOBD 2.
No, I think I have to do a first-person shooter next or something to cleanse myself of making a weird game.
Cool. Well, it's 10 p.m. now. Thank you. Thanks so much for coming on the stream and for sharing this stuff. Yeah, it's been super, super fascinating. I think this is gonna be. I'll probably be watching it again. The archives just to like pick up on stuff I missed, and it's it is. It's
Cool.
sort of like kind of showing me a lot of stuff that's like possible with the engine.
Yeah, this is
That I wasn't even aware about of.
And if anybody has who watches this later, like, and just feel free to either send me a message on Twitter or just tweet at me or something. I'll try to explain if there's questions. Yeah, it's been, thanks for having me on the stream. Like, this is really cool to do.
We like there's a lot of people interested in shader and stuff, and that's like I've kind of always mentioned stuff that's going on with your game. Plus, also when you gave me the buffer, what's it called? When you save one, the example script you sent me.
Oh
Yeah, it had the.
the oh what's it? I don't even remember.
It has a
I know
really
what you're talking
awful
about.
name. But it sort of. Grab
The
pass,
grab,
grab
yeah, grab
pass.
pass.
Yeah, it's
Yeah.
just this.
Yeah.
David Kilmer says thanks for talking to us, Ezra.
No
And
problem.
well,
Thanks
I'll
for
see you
coming
around.
by. Cool, man. Yeah, I'll talk to you later on the Twitter
Yes.
sphere or whatever. All right, cool, man. Thanks.
Right, see ya. All right, cool. So that was Ezra talking about Memory of a Broken Dimension. Super, super awesome. I feel like we all learned a lot. I had my mind blown in several parts. I'm gonna sign off now and then upload this to archive it on Twitter and onto YouTube. I'll post it once that's up. And thank you all for joining us and have a great weekend. And also follow the channel if you liked it. And next Friday, we're going to be talking to Tanya X Short about Moon Hunters. That is the name of her game. It's not just Tanya, it is Kit Fox game, so totally different. We're going to be checking out Moon Hunters, a co-op game about building your own mythology, RPG style. Very different, but I think also very, very cool. So we will but on Wednesday I'll be doing development streaming. I'm gonna be get back into coding. I'm gonna understand water, start working with that. I'm kind of like I kind of want to start playing with particle effects, but that's a totally different ball game. I'll leave that to Ezreal. So next week Wednesday, more code. Friday, Moon Hunters. And have a excellent weekend, everyone. I'll see you later.